Please stand as you are able, as the word of Christ, the word of our Lord, comes in our midst. Chapter 2 of Luke, verses 41 through 52, we hear these words. Now every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up as usual for the festival. When the festival was ended and they started to return, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but his parents did not know it. Assuming that he was in the group of travelers, they went a day's journey. Then they started to look for him among their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem to search for him. And after 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished, and his mother said to him, "Child, why have you treated us like this? Look, your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety." He said to them, "Why are you searching for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he said to them. Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. His mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in years and in divine and human favor. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. As we end 2018 tomorrow night, we anticipate the new year coming. We have spent time thinking about what we should have done, what we could have done, and then we spend an awful lot of time thinking about what we shouldn't have done. I jokingly tell you that we have a refrigerator door at home that is filled with honeydews that my wife puts on it, hoping that I'll get them done. But I've started a New Year's resolution and think that probably what I'll end up doing is just buy another refrigerator and set it alongside to let other honeydews go over there. And yet, as we look towards the past year, I have to tell you a story about a young woman in Minnesota that lost her husband to a sudden heart attack at the age of 35. And she was left with 5 young children. She was in school working on her college degree. They were remodeling an old farmhouse by adding more rooms so that the children would each have their own bedroom. That first Christmas after the death of her husband was going to be very lonely and tearful, not only for her, but for her children as well. The young widow was doing her best to make things bright and cheery, especially for the 3 boys and the 2 girls. So one day there was a knock on the door. I'm sure the thought that went through her mind was, gee, I wonder who that could be. When she opened the door, she found her pastor standing there at the door with his arms full of toys and candy. This man, who was well known in the area, said quite simply, "I thought your boys and girls might be missing their dad this morning, so I brought these." He just got down on the floor and spent the next few hours playing with the children, sharing their gifts of toys and dolls and candy. I think that minister became a living example of the meaning of Christmas. His caring demonstrated what the birth of Jesus was all about, better than I think any sermon could ever be. Christmas means God humbled himself to come to a place where we live. The Word became living flesh as God willingly shared in the joys and the pains of our existence. The birth of Jesus means God took upon himself all of the frailties and the limitations of this earthly body. Our text shows that God is communicating to us by entering into the life of that young boy who grew up, I am sure, like all the rest of the boys in his hometown. The gospel, according to Luke, emphasizes the fact, by the way the account is begun and ended, in the prelude of this passage, we are told that the child grew and became strong. The postlude summarizes it by saying, and Jesus increased in wisdom and in years and in divine and human favor. Many artists and writers have distorted the scene of that 12-year-old Jesus in the temple, and yet Luke describes Jesus as sitting amongst the elders and listening. I can only imagine, like any boy of that young age who has been raised in a devout home, he listened with respect to the elders and the priests. Years later, I'm sure, as Mary is gazing up at her son on the cross, she must have thought about that incident. And yet, she must have just shaken her head in wonder. Do you remember that touching moment in Fiddler on the Roof when Tevye sings, is this the little girl I carry? Is this the little boy at play? I don't remember growing older. When did they? How often Mary must have thought something like that as she watched God's son grow into manhood and become the magnificent preacher and teacher. Can you imagine what the neighbors thought as they looked at the grown-up Jesus with such head-shaking wonderment? And they would exclaim, I don't believe it. Isn't he the carpenter's son? Is that the little boy at play, and is that really Mary and Joseph's son? I don't remember growing older. When did he? Maybe Mary and Joseph had their first and only clue other than the scene at the nativity, that he was different in that moment in the temple. Perhaps something deep and profound stirred within him as he answered their distressed question with the words, why are you searching for me? Didn't you not know that I must be in my Father's house? These are the first words ever recorded that Jesus spoke. In those words, we see the first self-conscious emergence of his special identity. After all, he was the Son of God. But other than that one moment, we have no reason to suspect that Jesus had other than a normal boyhood. God also communicated in humanly understandable terms when he chose to have his special son raised in a home like many others. He didn't grow up in a wealthy home. We can tell Mary and Joseph were persons of small means by the humble thank offerings that they would bring to the temple. His parents showed respect for the sacred laws by bringing their son to the temple on the prescribed eighth day for the required ritual of dedication. Whoever has brought a young child to God's altar for baptism can identify with that scene, such as we will see here today later in our service. So can any parent identify with the scene described in our text, who has ever worried over and scolded a child who has lost track of time. Mary and Joseph were very normal. They worried when their son was missing. Then when they found him, all their pent-up worry and anxiety poured out. Child, why have you treated us like this? Look, your father and I have been searching for you with great fear. Mary and Joseph could not have been more ordinary and more human than when they revealed themselves in those words. Remember Luke's observation that as Jesus grew, he increased in divine and human favor. Jesus blessed every life he ever touched. I think too many people forget this. Worst of all, they have treated religion as though it had nothing necessarily to do with the everyday matter of keeping human contact warm and loving. So as we looked at Jesus and his effect on his parents and then ultimately the world, so let us look at our calling for the coming year. Back in 1980, Stephen Covey once said that the key to managing life is distinguishing between the urgent and the important. He stated the urgent matters clamor for our attention, but the important matters shape our lives. So two critical, important questions every person here today must ask and keep on asking throughout their whole life is, who am I? Why am I here? So let's take a look at these questions. First of all, who am I? In the book, Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, Stephen Covey looks at these two questions, who am I and why am I here? We all have mothers and fathers, brothers and sisters, aunts and uncles, and lots of others who feel compelled to tell us what to do. Parents want us to sleep all night. They may even expect us to clean our rooms, pick up our toys, straighten up our tools and shops, and behave in a prescribed way, at least when company comes, or when you're over visiting somebody else's house. Don't embarrass us. I heard that more than once as I was young. Siblings seem particularly concerned about proper place in the pecking order. In the TV series currently running, This Is Us, we see the terrible yet loving placement of siblings in the family. I did a funeral this last Friday, and as I met with the family, the brothers and sisters came into my office. And the oldest, when she came into my office, said, I just want you to know that I'm the oldest in the family. I'm in charge, was the hint that I got. And the list goes on. Employers expect you to show up on time, get the job done. Communities expect you to obey the speed limits and refrain from trespassing. Churches want us to support them with prayers, presents, gifts, services, and witness. I found out that there's a strong saying down here in the South which goes, if mama ain't happy, yeah. So can you imagine what Mary, the mother of Jesus, was feeling as this whole event unfolds? What she wants to know is why Jesus would treat his parents that way, like he did, as she says, it with all anxiety of any parent who has lost a child. Some of us here today need to answer our identity question once and for all. Who are we? Let me tell you, and remember this, you are a loved child of God. Don't ever forget it. Secondly, we must ask the question, why am I here? As a 12-year-old child, Jesus had it figured out. Didn't you know I had to be about my Father's business? Was this statement an act of adolescent rebellion? Or is it a truth? Note how Jesus finds his purpose in life by being about his Father's business. Is God at the center of your being, or simply sailing around the circumference of your identity? What about in life? What about work? What about at home? Here at church, we must make the main thing God. After the week of VBS last summer, I listened to our youngsters give their presentation on Friday evening. Whatever they may have lacked in precision, they made up with passion. As they sang, I found my mind affirming the truth in my soul. He is big enough to rule the universe, but small enough to live within each of our hearts. So what do we do for Jesus? We clean the house, we preach sermons, we go to school, we make the sales, teach the children, tend to patients, read the books, earn money, serve the community. And it is all not for our sake or glory, rather it is all for Him. Do not let your goal be for things or your ear to hear the self-applause derail you from giving God the honor and glory. So let me ask you again, why am I here? I'm here to serve others. When James and John were jockeying for position, you read it in the Bible. What is it that Jesus said to them? The Son of Man did not come to be served, but be served, but to serve others. There are certain things that servers do. Servers think first about others instead of themselves. The mantra of a server is, what may I do for you? Not what can you do for me? What did John F. Kennedy say in his inaugural address? Ask not what your country can do for you, but ask what you can do for your country. Servers seek to give, not to get. Servers seek the common good over personal gain. Serving is not about winning or losing. It's about sharing. There's no place for petty jealousy among servants. Life is not about getting there first. It's about being faithful to the end. Servers see ministry as an opportunity, not an obligation. So let me ask you again, why are we here? We are here to make a difference. I think one of the greatest stories told in the Bible is about Jesus feeding the 5,000. It's late in the day. The disciples hadn't gotten any food together or anything like that. And you know, there's no fast food places along the Sea of Galilee. No Wendy's, no McDonald's, no Captain D's. So Jesus performs a miracle and feeds the crowd with plenty of leftovers for the disciples to take home. The whole thing was made possible by a little boy who happened to have a small lunch consisting of 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Yet this child, this boy whose name we don't even know, whose identity goes unmarked, did what he could, gave what he had. Willing to do that? Didn't you know I had to be about my Father's business? My true identity comes from my Heavenly Father. I am a beloved child of God. My main purpose is to be about God's business, and the main thing is to make the main thing the main thing. Thanks be to God. Amen.